Mayank graduated with honors in engineering from Rodriguez College of Engineering, University of Mumbai, and holds a master's degree in machine learning and enterprise business analytics from National University of Singapore. Also, we have PKS Prakash. So Dr. Prakash has over 12 years of data science experience with focus on healthcare, manufacturing, pharmaceutical, and e-commerce domain. He leads the advanced data science practice in patient analytics and customer-centric marketing at Xeres. So he has a doctorate from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, US, and also pursued his second doctorate in engineering from the University of Warwick, UK. He holds a master's degree from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, as I said, and they'll be speaking on the driverless forecasting, which is about solving short-term needs. In the workshop, both of them, they'll cover framework and examples for driverless forecasting, which aims to achieve accuracy and agility by using statistics and machine learning theory in practice. So ladies and gentlemen, we have PKS Prakash and Mayank Tewari. So Prakash, you're Prakash, sir. Okay. Okay, and Mayank is going on the stage. Can you give a big round of applause? Put your hands together, use some hands also. Well, I'm pretty sure they're using their minds, but sometimes the hands also need the exercise. Thank you.
So, is everyone able to hear me? Okay, very well. Thank you, Anupam, for that kind introduction. And we are lucky to have this slot, 2:30 post-napping time, right? So in this particular session, first let me just start with a bit of a background. So as Anupam mentioned, I'm Mayank Tewari. I'm currently a data science consultant with the ZS. I'm currently working in the advanced data science track of the business consulting division of ZS. ZS has a legacy of over 35 years. Today we are the largest consulting firm uniquely focused on sales and marketing solutions, primarily in the life sciences department. ZS offers high performance mathematics and analytics driven solutions to our clients in industries and countries across the globe. We have presence in over 22 offices, 22 locations around the world. Now today's session is on driverless forecasting. The key word here is still forecasting, but the highlight is the driverless. So we just wanted to take you through some of the endeavors, some of the experiments that we are doing in this space, and we hope that we would have a great discussion in this context. So before I move forward, I just wanted to have a quick show of hands that how many of us are familiar with forecasting. We have used it in our organizations or in one of our endeavors. Okay, very well. So I would say about 60% of our folks, of us, are familiar with forecasting. So that's great. With that, let me dive into it and take you for a drive, right? So this is a live poll. Let me start with some questions just to gather your thoughts. So this is about what are some key applications of forecasting. Let me just start the poll. I will be needing the mouse pointer in this, just to give me a minute. Yeah. So let me skip the poll. Apparently, I will need to open it and activate it. But let me go through the questions. I think we can skip the poll. We can, again, have a quick show of hands. So what do you think are the key applications of forecasting? Can we have a quick show of hands here, please? Got it. Got it. Stock price forecasting. Demand forecasting. Supply planning. So yeah, so let me see. We've got about 4 or 5 responses. Now if you see, we can sectionalize them into 2 primary things, right? We have demand forecasting and we have production planning. Now whatever you see in whichever industry you see, the forecasting applications can be put into demand forecasting and production planning. right? Now, these primary things, they feed into multiple downstream requirements in our modern organizations, right? Some of these applications we will look into more detail in coming slides, but that is something that I wanted to have a tick on, right? The second is, what are the typical methods that we use for forecasting? Let me start with a bit of a primer. We, of course, have the quantitative methods and we have the qualitative methods. Now, for the quantitative methods, what are the typical methods we use? Any pointers on that? Okay, so we have a lot of things. We have Hole filters, we have ARIMA, we have exponential smoothing. Great. So that is as simple as starting from regression to going something like ARIMA or Box Jenkins, right? So these are basically the methods. But one field which is coming up on top and which is a bit different from these fields is basically the machine learning aspect of it. If you see these methods, right, regression, ARIMA, Holdwinters, TBATS, ETS, Theta, all these methods can be categorized into statistical models. Now, in the modern world, we think about things like XGBoost, we think about gradient boosting machines, we think about recurrent neural networks, LSTMs. These are the machine learning aspects of the things. Now, there is a debate, or I would rather say a research which is going on to decipher the vortex of machine learning and stats and basically make them come together and amalgamate them. One of such endeavors was taken over by Marcus Davis. He is the father of modern forecasting. The initiative is taken forward by a way of conducting a competition known as MX competition. They recently conducted a competition known as M4 competition. It's a global forecasting competition, which was the fourth edition in last 45 years of this competition. The objective of this competition was, how do we achieve accuracy at a scale? What are the breakthrough advances in this field for achieving accuracy at scale? My colleague and my immediate senior in these endeavors, Dr. Prakash, he participated and partnered in M4 competition, and he ranked in top five in across the world. And some of the learnings from the M4 competition, we have tried to condense them into our workshop today. With this, I would like to call Dr. Prakash on the stage. He can take us through some of the primary concepts of forecasting, which is the focus of this discussion.
Sure. Thanks, Mayank. All right. Sure. Hello. Can you hear me? Awesome. Thanks, Mayank. All right. So Mayank has already. As I see, I think more than 50% of the folks here are already have some sort of forecasting experience. So what I'm going to do today, I think maybe I will continue the M4. How many actually know about M4? All right. So it's a competition. It's a fourth edition, which has been conducted in 45 years. And the whole objective of this competition is to evaluate any breakthrough in the forecasting. And they breakthrough, basically they measure in two dimensions. One is the accuracy, other is the stability of the solution. Another objective is how much the machine learning and statistics is working in tandem. So basically there's a lot of methods, as Mayank mentioned, which comes from a statistics arena. There's a lot of methods which come from the machine learning side, whether what is the best for the forecasting. Maybe I can conclude the finding in one line for this year. I mean, the major conclusion is none of them will win alone. It's the combination which wins, is a hybrid. So if you only go for statistical, you reach to some accuracy. If you go with ML, you reach to a certain accuracy. Is the hybrid, which actually give you the best performance. With that, the way we have organized this session, I think I still see there are few folks who have not from a forecasting, so I just wanted to give you a flavor about a forecasting. Before we actually jump into, when we say a driverless forecasting, what we are trying to achieve with this. And then we will end up with a demo of what we actually prototyping based on our learning from the M4. All right. So from a forecasting perspective, I think the broadly we can classify the forecasting into two major categories, long-term and short-term. The whole talk which we are going to focus today is going to be short-term forecasting, which mostly we are looking from a 1 month to 24 month time frame in terms of forecasting. You can go into very short-term, which is a week order, where we are trying to predict for next day or a 1 week kind of scenarios. So for the short-term forecasting, one of the reasons we want to go for a short-term forecasting is it's more operational. So in a short-term forecasting, you have to predict the things, you have to rerun the things continuously to further to improve your accuracy and basically give the operation the things which they want. Whereas the long-term forecasting fall more into strategic decision-making. We want to make a call, we do a once in 25 years, so it make more sense to bring a human judgment because there's a demographic changes, there's a lot of other events which can come into picture. So it will go into more a qualitative kind of framework. So for the short-term, Mayank has already covered there, and you guys have already given a lot of application for a short term. The way actually I define, there is a downstream application for a forecast, which is a demand which we are trying to predict for a consumer, which have a direct impact on the upstream, which is as a inventory optimization, logistics. So you actually have to automatically production planning and control, manufacturing planning. There's a lot of things which it actually get fed into. So there is a lot of application. Again, because it has so many applications, the stakeholders also, there's a lot of stakeholder which comes into picture. So if I'm giving a forecasting for a demand planner, automatically because it gets fed into manufacturing planning, so the manufacturing people also become a stakeholder. Then sometimes because that also going to impact my revenue, so automatically the investors also become a stakeholder. So what number you are quoting in terms of revenue for my firms in next 6 months. So there's so many stakeholders which are coming with their own views for a forecasting. So the change management itself is a very big thing when you go and actually start implementing a forecast in companies. So just to give you a scale, maybe it's a more from a pharma perspective. So if you look into pharma typical projects, you will actually see a lot of data sources which we have to connect. So the data, bringing them together, create that at a level which we can use it for a forecasting. Then SKUs, the way we actually define the SKUs potentially in the pharma could be at a country brand level and a channel level, where the country brand become your drug which they are actually having. The channel is the source of income business for them. So for example, it could be government, it could be commercial payer, which is the Medicaid, Medicaid. So that's the source for them. There could be other ways the company can break the SKU, so they can have a dosage as another way to break the SKU. So you have a 75 mg pill versus 125 mg pill, so that could become an SKU for you as well. There is another way they can actually further break it down is on indications. So for a one brand, there could be a multiple indications, so they want to see the forecasting at the indication level. So so the number can actually go bigger than what you see here, depending on how we actually define that SKU from a client to client. If you go from a pharma to retail, right, the number of SKUs will be in million. So the scale can go very, very high. The other critical dimension is how you evaluate the forecast. So there are two metrics. I think most of the people actually look from an accuracy perspective, but then there is a stability. So if I look from an M4 perspective, there are two major metrics which they are actually using. One is the standardized mean absolute percentage error, SMAPE, which actually is used to evaluate the accuracy for a system. The another one which they are actually using is MACE, which is mean absolute scaled error. The purpose of the MACE is, to some degree, you can see how good your model is doing with respect to the naive base, one-step naive base model. So if I'm building a RNN and I'm not doing a better than a naive base model, I mean, it's not a useful model to run, right? So it's actually, to some degree, telling me how good I am from a very simple naive system, even without predicting anything. So it can also be used to just the stability of a system. So that's the from the accuracy perspective. But once you forecast the system, the other way the pharma company looks is how good the model is doing at a different resolution. So for a next month, next quarter, quarter two, quarter three, overall. So there is a possibility that I end up doing a very good forecast or a very bad forecast for a series, but I'm doing a very good for two of the metrics. Maybe I'm doing very good for the next month because my autocorrelation for the next previous time period is so good, is 0.99. So next month is automatically become very good, even using a naive-based kind of system. But as I go far, it become bad, right? So there is another problem because most of the forecasting which we are setting right now, we set up with a supervised prediction assumption, which has an assumption of a stochastic process and with the expected loss. So automatically we are making a lot of assumption on the distributions which we are actually using. So that's where I think there could be a lot of different aspects when we are evaluating what we are forecasting for a system. In terms of what is critical, there are four major dimensions through which we actually evaluate the forecast. Accuracy is one of them. So it's important because it helps me to minimize the uncertainty of the process. So I need to be as accurate as possible. But sometimes the questions come as the interpretability. So and this become important if my forecast start varying a lot from my actuals. So if I predicted something and I see in next month that there is a lot of gap in terms of what I predicted and what it comes out, then the next questions come is why is that happening, right? So we need to be interpretable in terms of what we are forecasting. The third dimension is again very critical is agility. So our system need to be agile because we are talking about a driverless forecast. We want to minimize the human intervention into a process as much as possible. So my system should be able to take any changes in the process in terms of events or data and able to figure out the right combination to predict or forecast the series. Scalability is again a very critical aspect. So as we go and start increasing our SKUs, my system should be scalable enough to predict predict the series. So let's do a small quiz again, potentially. So just create a boundaries around what I'm going to ask, right? So there are three series over here. We actually tried around eight different methods, which actually listed on the top, which is a linear system, exponential smoothing, ARIMA, you have XGB, XGBoost model from a forecasting perspective, we have RNN, MLP, which is multilinear, perceptron, seasonal ARIMA, and theta, a based forecasting method. Now, you have three different series. So what do you think, which will perform better? For series one, linear model. Okay. I see. Okay, so linear model. Okay. What about the second one? Actually, I will open all of them at the same time. Seasonal ARIMA, okay. Awesome. Third one is ARIMA as well. Awesome. Okay, let's see. So, I think for two of them, yes, I think the first one is a linear model, which fits better. The second one is SARIMA, but we have to regularize it a bit because there is a mean shift which has happened to a process, if you see. So if you actually just go by a SARIMA, it will not fit the time series better, or you will end up overfitting the system. The third one, ETS, comes out to be the best. So we actually just deep dive. I think some of you have already guessed why. When we look at the properties of this time series, I mean, I am just mentioning around four. There are more properties which actually look when we actually see the time series. But some of the most critical properties are the entropy, linearity, trend, and the seasonality into a system. The first one, as you see, there is very less entropy. There is no randomness into a process. Very linear system. High trend, which we see, very little seasonality. And just because of this, I think any linear model will be able to extract the seasonality and the trend from a system, and it actually tends to predict much better. The second one, as you see, it has much high entropy randomness as compared to the first one. No linearity, very little linearity into system, no very little trend comparatively, some seasonality is present. The third one, there is no trend, less entropy, there is a seasonality which is there, which need to be modeled. And that's why ETS is able to capture the seasonality, is a standard seasonality to capture. The second one, we have to bring the regularized component into a system just to take care of the mean side. But yes, I think that's the majority of you actually guessed the first two right, so it's good. But I think there are some properties which are critical, which we need to look into from the perspective of time series. So why we are actually calling it a driverless? Let me give you a perspective. So how many of you know Waymo? Right. So it's a self-driving car by Google. It's a competitor to Uber. I mean, if you follow news, I think they have recently filed a case against Uber self-driving car. They have actually taken a lot of their proprietary stuff. If you actually look at the major component which drive the self-driving car, there are four major component. One is, the first is the acquisition, right, which is actually defined by the camera or the lidar system which they have, which actually the whole idea is how you can actually automatically capture the data. And so if I can look from a forecasting perspective, again, there is a two kind of data which is critical, even from the forecasting. One is which you get from a client, basically the transactional information. The other is the external events which is happening. If we have a ability to capture the events which is happening into the market, which is critical from the market perspective. In pharma, if I have to give an example, or in any industry, I think holidays, in e-commerce, there is even a big billion sales is going on in me or in my competitor, that could have a lot of impact. So data acquisition is very critical, and basically how we automate the data acquisition, that is also very critical for the forecasting. The second is again a very critical component from the self-driving car is the object detection module. So when they actually take an image, they are able to segment all the object into an image and make a call what they have to do. So similarly, when you actually, from a analogy in terms of forecasting, when we actually get a time series, one of the critical, I think most of you have able to guess the first two right, because you are able to see there is less, there is almost no variance, very less entropy, there is only trend present in a system. So it's actually give me a, you are able to segment the time series very well, and that's actually helps you to perform which things should go where. That's where the second comes into picture. Another component from a time series perspective is the feature engineering. How we actually model that, how we extract those features and basically take that into forecasting module. The third one is the optimization. So steering optimization. As soon as I know about the object, how I navigate while driving. So same analogy from a forecasting perspective is, as soon as I know the time series properties, in terms of my pipeline for forecasting, how should it navigate to reach to an optimal forecast? So it actually is my strategy to predict the forecast using the optimal algorithm. What is the optimal setting for the forecasting? The fourth one is even more critical from a forecast perspective. So for them, I think is the sensor. So sensor is more around handling any surprise. So if you are actually driving and suddenly something comes out very close to you, you have to take an action. Similarly, from a forecasting perspective, the sensors are, okay, my system is able to run the forecast, but at the end of the day, I realize something is wrong. So how and when I should bring human in the loop? I mean, that's one of the critical component, because one of the challenges, I mean, even with the self-driving car, is what should be the regulation? So there is a special regulation which has been passed in US to allow self-driving car in Nevada. On the same settings, I can make a system driverless, but we have to bring a human in the loop just to ensure all the stakeholder requirements are taken care of. So there is the fourth component, how you actually handle the sensor or the human intervention. So when you bring all these four, you are able to actually create a system which is actually really a driverless from a forecasting perspective, and will help you to reduce a lot of human effort or intervention. So from a forecasting, there are four different components. I mean, the data ingestion, how we actually automate the data ingestion part, how we actually automate the feature engineering part, what feature need to be created, what should be my model selection criteria, and what is the, when I should actually generate an alert from the system. So it's an auto alert driven framework. So these are the four modules along which we are trying to prototype our auto forecasting or a driverless forecasting system. So maybe I will end up before with an example from the M4. So the way potentially the M4 is set up. So again, I mean, there is a lot of algorithms which actually is going within M4. Just to give you the scale of the M4, there are around 100 K series which we have to forecast. And they are from multiple business units. From a micro, macro industries, financial industry, demographic, others, and with a different resolutions. So some forecasts are yearly, monthly, quarterly, hourly, daily, weekly. So there is a different resolution forecast which you have to predict. There is no domain information in this one. If you go into a real forecasting project, you will have a lot of domain information, a lot of events which you can actually capture. But in this one, the objective is just to evaluate if there is a value of bringing a statistical and a ML together, or basically from the technique perspective. So there is a lot of methods which actually we end up using around 24 different methods. So I will not go in the detail of all of them, but there are roughly 24 different methods which sits into proprietary. They are a combination of stats and ML. In terms of evaluation strategy, there is two metric which we are actually using, SMAPE and MACE. SMAPE is mostly for the accuracy, whereas MACE is actually used to create a gate into a system to evaluate how good the model is. So what we are trying is, and to be able to do that, we have to optimize the critical value of the MACE at a resolution level for each of the series. So that what the whole system is set up, and it's actually tried to optimize with the SMAs as an objective. So we are trying to achieve accuracy, but we are also trying to stabilize the series. So just to pick the system. So based on whatever we have done, we actually come back and we have created a prototype for a driverless forecasting. I think this is also important because the Vimo supposed to launch their service for user by end of 2018, and also we are planning to launch the auto forecast within ZS by the end of 2018. So that's why both are driverless, both potentially is going to come this year. With this, I will hand over to Mayank. I think he will go through the demo.
Thank you, Prakash. Thanks, Prakash. Thanks for the primer. Give me a minute just to get me around this laptop and start the demo. Excuse me. I've extended the screen. Can I duplicate? So we're just trying to duplicate the screen. Just give us a minute. Can we extend the screen? That is also fine. Extend the screen. Okay, so essentially we have, what we have done over here is we have a notebook where we have tried to condense some of our learnings and the prototype that we have built so far. We conducted multiple experiments and this kind of summarizes it. Meanwhile, when I get the background, let me just run all of this so that we can essentially have all the real outputs here. So right now, this Jupyter notebook is running at runtime dynamically. Now let me start with the background on this. Right, so Prakash gave us a primer on what are the key components in driverless forecasting. But today, as a means of this, I want to take you to a journey that a typical forecaster goes through when he is actually working on a typical forecasting project. So I wanted to take it into three steps. If you see, basically, these are my three steps which are over here. Right? The very first, the font is a bit small, so let me read it out for you. The first is a day in the life for a forecaster. The second is basically the decision conundrum that he faces every day and the decisions that he has to make. And the third one is the driverless angle that we are trying to build into it. So let me go into it go for this. Just give me a minute. I don't like this background, so I'll change this. Okay. Fine. I think this one is better. Okay, so first is basically what happens in a typical day for a forecaster when you are given a particular problem, right? So if you have a problem, there are multiple steps before you actually start getting into the design of the problem. And these are the steps which need to be done unless and until you have a standardized platform in which everything can be integrated. Some of these things are basically you have to set up the environment, you have to ensure that the things are basically in sync. Then essentially you go into loading the libraries and the helper functions which you may and may not have written. Now these libraries and other functions, some of them may be open sourced and some of them may be something that you have done in-house. So these are some of the mandatory steps, right? Then what we do is you load the data. First you try to find out the structure of the data. The data that we have used over here, it's an abridged version of what we got from the M4 version. We have tried to mask it a bit more, but typically you can expect to see something like this. If you have multiple brands working in multiple countries, you can expect a lot of series, and for against each series you have certain level of historical periods, you have a start date, you have the end date. So this is the structure of the data. Then you start going into it and you start looking at the things like, what is my data snapshot? These are some of the simple things that you do just to get a bit warmer in terms of getting your environment ready. Now you get into a bit of a detail. So what you do first is, suppose I have the sales of a particular drug which is launched in multiple countries. So first you try to have a statistical summary of these just to get a hang of the data that how the level shifts are happening across the country and across the demographics and the regions, right? So you look at some of the familiar things, the 5-point summaries that we we have, you have mean, average, variance, standard deviation, and other things, right? These are something quantitative, but of course, in forecasting, half of the things are done by using your eyeballs. So basically, you visualize them, and you see how the things are moving across, and you try to see, as you did when we actually asked that particular quiz. You visualize the data, and with that, you were able to infer that what kind of method would be helpful for it, right? So this is something that the forecaster has to do for each of the cities that he has, right? Now, we start to get a bit deeper into it. We start studying the atomic properties of the series. These are the time series properties. Some of the very macro properties that we all are aware of, things like seasonality, trend, and we have something called a long-term seasonality, also known as cyclicity. But apart from it, there are certain minute patterns which we all know, but it is hard to quantify. If you see in the quiz that was presented, we presented a gradient there. But what is important is to quantify that gradient. And these are the things which quantify it, right? So you have multiple metrics here. You have trend, you have entropy, you have linearity, you have something called lumpiness. Lumpiness is something like, is the variance changing erratically over time? Is it? It is the variance of variance. I'll not go into the details of it. Then you try to see the change points. These change points are important in order to understand what are the outliers of the market events. You may take a decision that this is one of an event, or this is a climate, a natural calamity which happened because of which I see a jump in the system and I need to remove it. But how do I recognize it when you have streams of data coming in the input? So you need something in order to assess it, and there are multiple ways to do it, right? So you have change points, and you have something called level shift. Level shift is basically if you have sales of the same product, basically what is the level shift over time for a typical product? Right? So here we are just getting a bit warmed up. We are inching towards the design element of the forecasting solution. What you do next is we go ahead and we try to decompose the series into the things that we have just quantified, just to visualize it. So we do something called STL, quite common in the forecasting world. So that is the seasonality and the tree trend decomposition using Loewe's and some of the things, methods. But basically by this, we are just trying to understand how the things are moving around, right? Is there any, what is the irregularity in the system? What is the seasonality? This seasonality is more of a, you see, more of a monthly level, yearly level, quarterly level of what, right? So these are some of the things that we do in order to understand the data, right? This is just in a demonstration for that. Now, if you get deeper, we realize that in the practical systems, the signals, they basically have multiple seasonality components. And if we want to decipher them very clearly, some of the techniques are called fast Fourier transforms. In very simple terms, it just tries to break down the frequencies of the signal, and it just tries to give you that one typical signal, which does not have any fixed sequentiality, how it can be broken down. In short, if you have multiple seasonalities into your system, this is something that you can give in, which can give you an insight into it, and you can select which ones out of these can be selected for the final model, right? So fast Fourier transform, this particular figure it just explains, so basically in a very simple terms, I'm just trying to break down my signal, which has multiple seasonality into components, and I'm just trying to decipher which one of them is important, which one is not, right? For using this, we use something called spectral density. I'll not go into the details of it, but basically, the way is you try to understand the important components of any given signal so that you can recompose, right? So basically synthesize the important aspect of those signals before it can be fed into the system. You can think of this as a cleaning system, right? Now, after doing all of this, we of course have our familiar ACF and DPACF plots. These are the, this is the fundamental forecasting diagnostics, right? We try to have a look at whether there is an autoregressive component or there is a moving average component, and you try to look at the correlations of the particular series with itself and try to assess from it. Once we do this, after all of this, right, you get into the modeling stage. And then when you open the modeling Pandora, what do you have? You have 80, 90, 100, 120 models. And what do? You have to select You have to run those models, and you have to select which one of them are making sense. How do we try to make sense of it? We try to keep the model, we try to keep the MAPE, we try to keep the SMAPE, and then essentially we build something like these graphs. And we say, oh, something is making sense, something is not making sense. And here you have a lot of qualitative assessment and qualitative decisions coming to the mind, right? Now, once you have selected the key models, you still don't know whether this is the best model. Right? So still you will just not make the decision on the absolute and the combined quantitative accuracy metric. You will try to visualize it and see, okay, is it like I'm just cutting through the average and because of this I'm getting the lowest error? Is it actually making sense of any signal or not? So what we do? Basically we plot all of them. So we plot all of this, and this is just for the five signals. We plot all of this, and we try to see which one is making sense and which one is not making sense, right? After this, we have to take a decision with which model should we go forward, and the more higher degree of complexity is if we have to amalgamate certain models in order to create a hybrid or an ensemble. Some of these models, they do not work on a space which is a grid search, right? It is an optimization space of high dimension. Some of these things we cannot even try if we go by a brute force technique because all of the combinations can't even be tried, right? So we come to the decision conundrum. This is actually just a step of the things. It is the summary of what we have discussed. So you have to set up the environment. You have to assess the data to get the nerves of the data. You have to decompose and read. You have to enhance the signal to noise by putting out the frequency components which do not make sense, the FFT example that we took, right? You build models. You evaluate, optimize models. You discuss with the team. And then you monitor. Because you don't know that models that you have chosen, how long they would last. Basically, what is the shelf life of it, right? So these are the things that a forecaster goes through in his day. Now we are trying to think about and talk about a driverless angle. Now imagine a system in which many of these things are taken off your decision library or your decision plate. So you, as a forecaster, the person can optimize his time and actually spend his time on a better decisions and taking better, looking at more important data where we do not have that much data and we need human intelligence, right? So, and if you're able to take off so many things, what do you get? Basically, I'm inching towards, hey, why not we automate everything and everything is done? But is automation, complete automation, an answer? We don't think so, right? If we automate rocket science, it will become not usable. It will be unusable. So if we are automating something, we still have to get the nerves of the system. So it has to be interpretable, and the system has to reach out for help. It has to intimate and it has to reach out for help. And this is what we call the alert-driven human intervention. So basically, if you have a system, the system is noticing that there are some changes in the system, it does not take a decision by itself. It intimates the users, and that is where the forecaster plugs into the system, and he takes the decision which are basically cannot be licensed and cannot be delegated to an automated system. Right? Here I have at a high level basically what is the overall breakup of such a system. So if you see, I will not go into too much of details, but essentially we have the three facets of the triangle that Prakash showed. We have something called feature engineering. And feature engineering is, of course, after the data ingestion. So data ingestion is not even, we are not even counting it in this, right? We have feature engineering, we have feature selection, we have modeling. And if you break into it, we have all these steps that you heard about. You have signal breakdown, feature engineering, feature transformation, breakdown into components, that is the analysis, then resynthesis into the signal. Then you have to run diagnostic tests. And these are the aspects which will tell the user that why the system has taken a decision, the decision that it has taken. Right? So these are the diagnostics tests that you run on each of the signals. Then you move ahead and you run multiple models. How do you run so many models, right? I mean, it's understandable that you have automated the system by running the models automatically, but you're still going through the entire search space, right? Even if we have a very big system with a lot of compute power, it will still take a lot of time. So you use optimization problems and optimization solutions like something called evolutionary algorithms or genetic algorithms to make smart choices such that your search space is smaller. If your search space is made smaller by making smart decisions, then you can complete the same process and have higher probability of reaching an optimal solution within the same time frame. Right? So that is what comes into the model selection, dimensionality reduction. And again, if we have a system of this sort, it is equipped enough to evaluate the N symbols of the system, M symbols of the models to come up with a hybrid model. So even if I have only four models, the total number of combination, including single models, is again 4C1 plus 4C2 plus 4C3. It is a lot. So in order to evaluate all of them, we need a capability of this sort. Right? And towards the end, of course, we have the validation diagnostics, because this is what is shown to the forecaster to ensure that the decision that the system has taken is actually the right decision for the current problem in hand. Right? So this is essentially the overall approach. Yeah, sure. Got it. So feature engineering, what all we have. So how I see it is, in feature engineering, first, I see it as a very simple process of analysis and then re-synthesis. So when you are analyzing it, you're decomposing it into its atomic properties. So basically, suppose, let me take an example of FFT. You have a signal, when you look at it, it does not make sense. Now when you will break it down, suppose you got four frequency components. Now you will be able to visualize each of those frequency components. Some of them will have its own amplitude and will own frequency, but what I'm trying to say is there are ways in which you can assess that how much variance of the system is captured by these frequency components. Maybe out of 10 or 20 components, the three components are explaining the maximum variance. So basically, if I'm taking only those three components and then I'm removing the remaining 17, I'm removing a lot of noise in the system which I'm not able to capture very well. Right? So basically, that is the decision that we have to take in the feature engineering. Now, this is a system, this is an example in which we broke it down, we selected something, and then we moved forward. Now, there is something called in which we have feature reduction. In the feature reduction, we have things like, similar to something called in the machine learning literature, we have something called PCA. Right? So basically, you have the variance captured in the different directions, and we are just trying to combine them so that I'm able to explain the maximum. These are the aspects which are covered in feature engineering. These are much more, but these are the things. Any other questions? Yeah? Great. Right. So let me take the pass at that. That's true, that you may have a lot of missing values. In fact, you may have negative values as well if there is an accounting situation. So in this scenario, there are decisions which need to be taken. Right? So the decision is still imputation. How that imputation is done, it depends on the system and your liaison with the client. Right? So basically, I may go ahead and I do a linear interpolation if my system is more stable. So let me give you an example. So if I have a stable sales of a product, I know that in this particular instance, I decompose my series so far because it is a stable system. I know that there is no frequency component or seasonal component in this particular month. Even if it is there, I recompose it in order to impute a value. Now, some of the simpler techniques are, of course, you go for a median, you go for mean and other things. Now, there are multiple ways in which you can take the mean of last n points of the same day, right? Median of the last n points. What I'm trying to say is you cannot run a time series forecasting with a missing value. It has to be imputed one way or the other, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. No, yeah, that is a very common scenario. So there are two ways to handle, right? And it depends on how the engagement is going. So first thing is, of course, if you're approaching it, there is a qualitative angle of a forecast and there is a quantitative angle of a forecast. Now, I'm sure that if a client has only 9 data points and is asking for 1 year in advance, I think that he is looking for a strategic decision. He wants to know that if I am going into it, how do I do it, right? So he is actually looking for the qualitative angle and the domain knowledge that given this kind of background, how this would move. Now, if we are pertinent to move by the quantitative angle, then there are two things. As I understand, and of course, we can move to Prakash. One is the total number of parameters a typical forecasting algorithm needs is 16. We cannot run a system with 9 points.
Yeah.
Right. The second is, if you are still saying that, okay, we have to go with the quantitative, what can I do? I can take a mean of the market, I can take the median of the market, and I can do the adjustments. So basically, I'm not using a dynamic algorithm to make a forecast 1 year in advance. I'm probably doing a forecast of next few months or days of 2-3 points based on the 9 points. And then basically, I'm using an educated, quantitative, simple metric calculation in order to give that.
So one question to us. So what I generally do is probably take a moving average, like, you know, if you have 8 or 9 months data.
Yeah.
So do you think hold winters would be a better approach because it's seen that exponential smoothing?
Yeah. So hold winters, Prakash, you want to take?
Right. Yeah, we can hear you.
From January to say September, right? And I'm trying to predict for October, that month cannot be captured because you cannot actually have that data to capture that monthly, but you still have data to capture the trend. So that what you can do at the best with the with the 9 month.
Just
and that's why I think what you are saying makes sense, right? You can go with the moving average kind of scenario.
Yeah. Just to add to Prakash's point, Holt winters, basically Holt and winters, I think 57 and 60 is when they came up with this. The idea was to capture seasonality. In order to capture seasonality, the level at which seasonality is present, you need to have at least 2 cycles of that seasonality in order to capture it.
Absolutely.
Right? If we don't have that, we cannot go after Holt winters, we cannot go to T-Bats or Arima because they will not capture it. The only point which can be captured is the trend part. Right, and so you basically trend it. You, of course, you can capture the level shift because that you can directly assess, but then that is the all the points that you have. You have the trend or the level shift, and then based on the domain knowledge and the market conditions, you try to sit around with the domain experts and try to see what kind of dynamics.
So one more question, last question. So I'm also from a consulting background.
Sure.
Since you all have the same background, I'm asking some question to you. So like, for example, if you have SQs which are, you know, new introductions, like, you know, you have data for only 7 or 8 points, that question which I had. So do you upfrontly tell your client that this is not possible, or probably, you know, give some values, like, you know, it's a complete dilemma.
Right. Well, of course, we have better folks than me over here from ZS who can help you. But at my level, basically what I see is, if you have just 9 points, we'll try to look at the literature, we'll try to look behind. Is there any kind of analog to that particular drug or that particular unit? If there is an analog, we engage with the client that, given these parameters, this is how we qualify this analog. If these parameters look good and the qualification is over 80%, then we will use the data of this particular analog to do any kind of quantitative activity.
So do you mean like SQs?
It could be client SQs. For instance, for your client, if he has having multiple products in the system, in the market, then is there any analog from the past which had similar marketing, similar launch scenarios, so that, you know, we can use that analog to model this problem? We can understand and we can talk this further offline.
Yeah, sure. But, yeah. Right. Thanks a lot.
Sure. It's a multi-language and multivariate system.
Right. So, were there any assumptions or anything?
Yeah. Yeah. So there are many examples that you you have to validate or you have to keep track of. If I have to start with a very simple scenarios, then if you have a multivariate system, there are two ways in which it can be multivariate. You have multiple regressors and you have multiple prediction elements. If it is multiple regressors, we have to keep in mind that the error and the error curves are normal. So basically you do a KS test for this. You have to see your auto regression. So you have something called Durbin-Watson test for this. So you have all of these things given there. But these tests, they are very concentrated on the stats part. The ML part is something it is supposed to gather these things from the data and model it. If enough amount of data is there, the expectation it will gather. But of course, these tests are to be done and given to the forecaster so that a decision can be taken. So to your question, yes, there are some tests that we do. Yeah.
So coming to the driverless,
right.
So is feature selection, feature engineering,
right.
Can be automated or only FFT, as you're saying, is the only solution?
No.
Right. So for a feature engineering, there are you can divide into two major buckets, right? One bucket is the system created features, and some of the features examples are the atomic properties which you see, right? So what is the linearity into system? What is the entropy, trend, seasonality, lumpiness, change points? And these help us to segment the forecasting series. And they also goes as the feature to help us to predict which model is going to drive or help us to better. So basically help me to segment the modules which I should use. The second feature, which is going as a regressor into a model, is more from a domain perspective. So in case of pharma, you can have a feature like how much spend I am doing if I'm actually looking for a market volume or market sales. So what are the spend I am doing? So what are my sales in a different things? What are the holidays? Because usually you will have much lower sale if there's a seasonality effect. And it could be a multiple seasonality into a process, right? So those actually goes as a regressor for a system. So that is very domain dependent. So that goes as an input, as a first part. So from a setup perspective, there are two steps through which we actually set up. One is the customization part or the setup process, and then the operational process. The setup is where you actually define the domain-related features. The system-related feature is AutoCAD computed internally. And the operation part, which then start running that in a more frequent basis. So some part is internal, some part is external.
Totally. So there are engines like Google's Auto ML is coming, KSML is coming,
yeah.
And S2 driverless AI is there.
Yeah.
They are automating everything.
Yeah.
What they are doing at the back is maybe brute force method, or maybe they are using something which
right.
Is not known. But do you think are they really useful?
Yeah. So I see this as two problems, right? So typically in our line of practice, if this is a surgical problem, I don't think AI is the complete solution. It is not AI versus human. It is AI with human. If we are thinking of a system which is generalizable and which can offer a generalized system over which you can make customization as per your requirement, then yes, you need the system that you are saying about that makes sense. So Keras and all those things, basically these are platforms which automate a lot of things for me. I'm using them, but basically those are not providing me the solutions. They are just providing me, it is like a direction which I hold on to, and then I carve my own path. Right.
So one way to look at is the generalist versus specialist.
Yeah.
Right. So all this Google ML, all these are generalist to some degree. Whereas when you create something which is very specialist for this is built for forecasting. So all the test and validation which we are doing is for forecasting systems. So that's where, both are critical. So.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
Please go ahead. I have a question. It's regarding from the ML perspective. So it's
can we take the question at the last? We'll just finish the notebook. I think it's just 5 minutes.
Sure.
Then we can.
Yeah, just give us 1 minute. I'll finish in 1 minute and come back to you.
Sure.
Okay. So essentially, this is where we start with the autofocused package. If you see, it's a one-line code which is written in R, but it's a multi-language system. So internally, it is asking for the Python codes. Okay. Now, these are the models which are running. It is running RNN models, XGBoost models, and the other models. Now, it will give you a familiar table that you see over here. But what does it give? It also gives you which is the best model that it is performing, and it will give you directions that what are those models and which one is performing best, right? So this is something that it can offer out of the box. Now, just to explain, that how the alert-driven human intervention would be needed is something like this. So here we have taken an outline in the system. Now what the autofocus package can do, it can tell you where it is saying the outlier, and then it can take some correction steps. It can remove the outlier and replace it, interpolate it, or it can keep it in the system if you force it to, right? But basically, if you do so, it will give you how this is performing with and without outlier. And this is of significance, because if we take the system outlier into the system, the overall forecast has been shifted by a level. Now, if this was a natural calamity or one of an event, the entire planning will go wrong. So this is where a human intervention is needed. And that is where the system should give out something. This is just a quantitative way of presenting the outliers, and that is it. So this was just how our endeavor has progressed so far. We are still doing some active experimentations, but this was just a glimpse of it. Now we can return to the questions.
Yeah. So from the ML perspective, let's say if we are talking about LSTM, RNN, or GRU,
yes,
which we are using for forecasting, then how basically, what's an ideal amount of data? Let's say just running a model with any of the technique, be it statistical or machine learning, won't, yes, help it out for solving a problem.
True.
So in our use case also, we had a problem. So where we had the data just for close to 3 years or so, wherein statistical approach were giving us pretty confident results. But compared to if we are running with LSTM or RNN, were not that appreciable. So in that case, in that kind of a scenario, how basically you try to leverage these solution using some kind of a machine learning approach, be it XGBoost or be it RNN?
Got it. So let me crystallize the question once. So the question is, given the ML techniques, so I think we are out of time. Let us take it offline. Okay?
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Check for the questions you can be asked offline. So Mayank, thank you so much. Prakash, thank you so much, both of you. And it's a small break, 20 minutes of tea break. I will resume back at 3:50 sharp for the next workshop. And also, don't forget, we have a competition going on. I hope everyone has uploaded their photos and hashtag Cypher everywhere.
I think so, because
see, you need
to have a high accuracy, right? But how do you know that you have a high accuracy? It has to sustain over.